I'll try to speak as loud as I can and everybody can gather around. We'll talk a little bit about this. Jimmy, Erik. Erik is with the Toledo Mud Hens. He's the executive vice president. And I'm a preservation architect. Tom is an architect. We all live, work, and play on St. Clair Street. I did one of these a couple years ago for St. Clair Street, the historic district, just up there. This is what's referred to as the St. Clair Historic District, from down there where Downtown Latte is, all the way up to where we'll see the building 28 is. 28 South St. Clair, which is the Spangler Candy building. We extended the district to include that when we started the project. And the Hensville project really consists of three buildings here, number 3 through 7, building number 9, the one with the black columns there, and then 28 South St. Clair, which is the Spangler Candy building down at the other end. The buildings were part of a memorandum of agreement the county had with the Advisory Council on Historic Preservation back in 1986-ish, I'm going to guess, when they built the convention center. So they agreed to maintain and market these buildings in no worse condition than they were when they built the convention center. So subsequently, when the Mud Hens came downtown, they were required to keep these buildings as part of that and build around it. They did. We have a wonderful Fifth Third Field, which I think is voted consistently one of the best in minor league baseball, for sure. And this was in the hands of a private developer who couldn't make anything happen. So after a number of years, no pun intended, the Mud Hens stepped up to the plate. And decided they would undertake these buildings. The buildings you see here, this one was what was referred to as lastly was the lease storage building, is where what was in here the latest. And they had this building and the building behind, which is the Mud Hens office, the 6-story one that's there. They decided they were going to move and they needed to take a piece of equipment out. They punched a big hole in the side of the building and had a crane come up there and take the piece of equipment out, and they left, including the hole. So the hole, 20 years of rain, snow, sleet, and everything else, had that wall fall onto the roof of this building. And subsequently, the roof ended up in the basement. So the county stabilized the project in the early 90s to just maintain and market the building as part of their agreement. So they did that. And subsequently that's the condition the building was in. So it was challenging for any local private developers to go about it. The building next door, number 9, there's a guy in the yellow shirt who can tell us more about it, but it was at one time was Fuller's Meats, correct? Mm-hmm. So these were both built in the 1880s, right? It's what we would refer to architecturally as commercial Italianate style. You can see the cast iron columns, very indicative of the architecture of the time. Think of Soho in New York City, you know, the cast iron storefronts they had there. So it's really an important part of Toledo's history architecturally, and the Mud Hens have decided that they have a use for it. So
thank you, Paul. Believe it or not, we've actually been downtown since 2002, so the ballpark's already 14 years old, which it seems like it's been about half of that. Time just goes so quickly. So as Paul mentioned, a couple years ago we decided, nothing was really being done with these buildings, and I'm building 28 down the street, so we started looking into if we were able to get involved, how could it help the warehouse district? How could it help the Mud Hens mission to continue what we're trying to accomplish and get as many people downtown and be a part of events downtown as possible? So we decided to get through the project, and now you can see we're about 6 months away from it being open. Everything's, knock on wood, so far on schedule. So we will be hoping to take possession of the buildings right around February 1st, where we can do some special events, some grand openings, and some things leading up to the ballpark. To give you an idea about what's going to be in each of the spaces specifically, the first floor is going to be an expanded swamp shop. If those of you familiar with the ballpark, we're going to expand the retail out a little bit and give us a little bit more square footage to do some of the things that we do well. And then starting, it's kind of between 3 and 9, about where that light pole is, from there over into building 9, we're going to open a restaurant downtown. It's going to be called 9. We've just released it. 9 for a number of reasons. It ties in with the address. It ties in with 9 innings of a baseball game. Lots of things that we can do with it. So we just announced the name of the restaurant. We're working on some menus and things, but it'll be a unique dining experience, trying to find a niche of places that downtown doesn't really have. So look forward for that this fall as more information about the menu and the theme and things come forward. The second floor is going to actually be a combination. The second floor in our building that Paul mentioned, 406 Washington around the corner, is linked up with 3 and 9. So there's going to be some expansion. The second floor is actually going to be a new kitchen that's put in that is going to be able to serve the restaurant and some of the other party spaces that I'll talk about in a few moments. And there's actually going to be some leasable office space in there. And we've got it's funny, we sent out some messaging within the last month or so about companies that might be interested in some downtown office space. And let's say we've had many inquiries and have been taking through people through the buildings over the last couple of weeks. So we're going to have some leasable office space on the second floor. The third floor, has anybody been to a Hens game and been in the roost, the banquet facility in the roost? The third floor, what we're going to do is knock out a couple of the walls there and actually expand the capacity of that banquet facility. So that will allow us, we do about 70,000 catered meals a summer, company picnics, church outings, you name it. That's going to allow us to expand that party space, which is one of our most popular party spaces, and basically go in capacity from right around 150 to about 300, which works great from a programming standpoint for us. And then on the fourth floor is actually going to be an outdoor party deck where we can rent out, not only for Hens games, and I guess I should take a step back. All the things we're doing, there's obviously going to be programming tied to Mud Hens games, but we're programming all these spaces for a wide variety of special events that we do even when the season's not in town. So it can be holiday parties, class reunions, wedding. We've already booked 10 to 12 wedding receptions between these banquet facilities and the one in 28 that we'll get to in a few minutes for next year and the year after. So there's a whole different sort of business that you don't think about when you hear the Mud Hens, because you think about the baseball component, but there's a whole nother business that we're in, special events that helps us, allow us to get more programmable space in for those sorts of events. So the fourth floor will be an outdoor party space tied to the roost fourth floor indoor current space that we have. And it will be a great outdoor party space that we can use for Hens events. The restaurant will use it on occasion for some outdoor seating. The view towards the river and the high level bridge and Owens Corning is fantastic. We've gotten some recent photos from up there lately. So it's going to be a unique party space that we're going to be able to do some fun things with. And then on the top of building 9, there's going to be about a 100-person party deck that will actually look into the ballpark that you can see baseball games going on. So kind of that Wrigley Field, Wrigleyville feel, where you're going to have a couple buildings along with building 28, which, like I said, we're going to get to. So a lot of different opportunities that this project is allowing us to do. Once again, to hopefully grow our business, expand our capacity a little bit, but continue the development of St. Clair Street and the warehouse district, as Paul touched upon. It'll be neat. You've seen all the progress down this way. When this block is finished off, it's going to be a fantastic accomplishment for downtown.
Yeah, the projects are being done as certified rehabs for tax credits. So we have involvement with the State Historic Preservation Office, the SHPO, and the idea is that you work in a particular manner, and consistent with what they call the Secretary of the Interior standards, you can get tax credits awarded to the project, and we have received those. And one of the things you can take a look at, it just went in, there's one of the restored windows. If you look 1, 2, 3, 4 there, what the storefront of these windows will look like when it's completed. And those are, an example of how they're going to meticulously put that back and really do a bang-up job on it. We've repointed the brick. We're about to clean it. Rebuilding all the windows. There's a number of things that go into it. We'll clean and repair the columns. But I think it's really going to be a spectacular-looking building when it's completed. So, and fun. I mean, I think it's neat. The idea of using the roof as a deck and having some views into the ballpark as well as some party spaces, I think it's great. So, any questions? We're going to try to walk down the street as we go here. Sure.
Is the deck going to be all open air?
It's open air. There's a little edge to it that does have a slight roof over it near where the serving of the food occurs. But yes, it's largely open air. So.
Will the restaurant be open during walleye games?
Yes, originally, and that's changed. Even over the last few months that we've been working on it, we originally thought, you know, you'd obviously tie it into hens games and big happenings downtown and walleye games, but that's only 110-120 events a year. We're now looking at it as open all day, evening, you know, probably like a Tuesday through Saturday sort of schedule, and then on Mondays and Sundays when there's games or events going on downtown. So as we've gotten into it more and we've kind of found the niche that we want to go after, we think it is going to be basically open all the time, not just in conjunction with Mud Hens or walleye events.
All right, if we walk down here, you can see there's a white truck there at the corner. If we gather near that white truck, that will be a good vantage point to take a look at the bank of the camp.
Sorry if we're talking to you behind, too.
I am doing the docents for the wall.
Okay.
And working the pool.
We're doing this as part of a certified rehab for tax credits. In order to do that, you have to be listed on the National Register. The National Register District stopped here, and so in order to do this, we expanded the district. We included this building, obviously, the building you see in the back there called the Event Center, and then there's a small building attached to that that's also included. Those three were added, and the district now encompasses those three. This building is I think, really unique because it's got some very tight mortar joints, and it's a yellow with iron spot brick that's a very, I don't want to say difficult, but you don't find that everywhere. You see a lot of orange brick. You know, everybody sees orange brick, but the yellow brick is tricky. So without making it the yellow brick road, the Mud Hens had some ideas for this as well.
So once again, this kind of falls into the master plan of why this building was of interest to us, and for the first 13 years downtown, you'd kind of look at it and you'd be like, wow, when is something going to happen? And then a couple years ago, as I mentioned down the street, we started getting creative and said, if nothing was going to happen, maybe we should take a closer look. So this building, 4 stories, the first floor is going to be more banquet and restaurant facility for our games or those private sorts of events that I talked about. The second and third floor, on the front side of the building looking into the ballpark, are going to be 6 suites that will be rentable on a night-by-night basis for private parties, companies, bachelor parties, all sorts of different applications, the same sorts of groups that we rent out some of the suites to in the ballpark. On the back half, the back two-thirds, I guess, or three-quarters, the second and third floor is once again leasable office space. So we're working out a plan with the potential partners there as to the shared space. The suites will be kind of a hybrid conference room by day for the companies leasing the office space, and then turn into suites for us and our events in the evening. So it'll be a unique, unique functionality for those spaces, something that you don't see in a lot of places. The fourth floor is going to be another banquet facility similar to the Roost. It'll hold about 200 people, and then that'll be in conjunction with the rooftop, which will be about 150 people. So you'll be able to see into the ballpark. We can split it up into multiple smaller groups or one large group that takes the spaces for their events, depending upon, you know, what this particular event is. But the views obviously into the ballpark are amazing. The right field video board is coming down. Believe it or not, it's actually kind of at the end of its technological life. So we've started to have a couple little issues with it. So the timing actually works well. We're looking at plans currently to expand the left field board and make it larger, and then looking at putting LED boards in the right field fence, similar to what a lot of major league parks are doing. So there'll still be something on the right field side even when this one comes down. But that will obviously open things up and provide great views from the second, third, fourth floor and rooftop if there's a game going on a particular evening. And then on the Monroe Street side of the building, it was a parking lot. It's about an acre space, give or take a little bit. We're turning that into Hensville Park. It is going to be basically a green space that we can do, once again, if you don't catch the theme, a lot of different special events tied into both Hens games and when the team is out of town or off season. So some examples of those, we're going to be able to do some concerts, some festivals, arts festivals. It'll hold about anywhere from, depending upon the sort of event, 1,000 to 3,000 people. You could do 3,000 people for like a standing room sort of concert. So we're looking at those sorts of events. We're looking at everything from putting a ice rink down in the winter, similar to what we did for Winterfest on the ball field, where people can come down and skate during the winter. We're looking at potentially doing like a New Year's Eve party, kind of like our version of Times Square, that we could make an annual event. So all different sorts of events, once again, some tied to baseball, some standing on their own, is something that will continue people coming downtown. So it's kind of a quick overview. I don't know if there's any questions about the building or the park. Yes?
Talking about bringing a lot of people down.
Mm-hmm.
Where's it going to park?
The parking, it's funny, depending on how often you come downtown, there's more than enough parking for a sold-out Hens game and arena concert, a walleye game going on at the same time. It's just a matter about kind of making sure people are educated as to where those spaces are. Believe it or not, there's plenty of places to park when there's a bunch of different things going on downtown. So there's no plans for any, other than the Prometica plans, which I don't know a lot about, but obviously they're going to be putting in some parking for their facility. There's no plans for new parking lots or anything. This lot only held about 80 cars on its peak night, so we're not taking a big piece of inventory out and not replacing it. But.
Were there any other questions at this point?
Do you know where the yellow brick came from?
I do not. I presume it was sourced locally through in Ohio, but I don't know if that it's a Belden or somebody specifically, but it's. I presume it was one of the other things that used to be in this neighborhood in and down the street was the National Supply Company, which eventually became Kuhlman Corporation. So there was an abundance of bricks available to everybody who wanted to do it. It's just the material of choice at the turn of the century. So, but I think it's really nice. It's neat to see. So. Okay, I don't know if they're coming out. Are they coming out? There they are. Beautiful. You guys can go in and upstairs to the second floor conference room there.
Sure.
That was a water tower.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, is that the ledge metal?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
That's you're very welcome.
Very
thank you.
Plans.
Thank you.
Tim.
It's going to be a fun time to be doing this.
Hi, Dad. How are you?
Hi, good. How are you?
We're actually it's a real unique situation. We're like a private not for profit. We don't have a private owner. We're affiliated with Lucas County, and there's lease agreements and arrangements with Lucas County that, at the end of our fiscal year, there's lease settlements and things that are taken care of. But the proceeds go back to the county to pay down debt service on both the ballpark and the Huntington Center.
So do you get any tax from that?
No.
We got the tax break from the building though.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, it's very interesting.
Thank
very
you.
Exciting.
It is. It is.
It's nice to see something being done.
Oh,
looks great.
Thank you.
Love the old building.